drinkers.
I'm going to take one of these out because it's really weird to hear myself back through the recording system in both ears at the same time. I'm really, really excited to be moving in a few weeks, obviously for the main reasons of like being with Chelsea and Cole and Charlotte, who you have not met yet, the cat. The cat has yet to make an appearance in the vlog. That will be happening soon. And also, of course, that I can set up my studio and have it functioning 100% of the time, 24 hours a day, be able to walk in and record and track and practice and film and do all of the things I love to do and basically make music all the time. And today I was kind of set up, I'm gonna take the other ear out as well because it's really uncomfortable listening to myself talk with in-ear monitors. I'm using in-ear monitors because the drum groove, the fun groove, is coming from the computer. It is going into the recording device and it's all kind of being tracked at the same time, and I have to monitor myself and listen to this track through the computer. That's the reason for the in-ear monitors. I hope I'll be able to do it where I can just monitor myself in the room and actually mic the cabinet when I have my studio set up. That would be awesome. So I'll have a direct line and a microphone to make it sound super warm. Right now it's just a DI out of the front of the amp into the recorder. And I thought I would share that with you today. I've been working on it, setting it all up, trying to get the sound right. Who knows at this point whether it's all gonna work out, but I thought it would be perfect. You guys would be perfect guinea pigs to check out the setup, at least the embryonic stages of the setup, the formative years, shall we say, of what the new setup might be. Plus, I've been working on a bunch of grooves today, which has been super fun. Got the P-Bass out, and I've literally just been going through Apple loops. That's it. I have Logic open right now, and I went down a bunch of grooves until I found some stuff I liked and started jamming to it. It's as simple as that. With the price point of Logic now being really quite affordable, I know it's not in everyone's price range, I don't want to exclude anyone from this, but for those of you who have Logic, don't sleep on the fact that you have thousands of drum loops to practice. And that was really kind of highlighted how important that was in my formative years as a bass player developing my groove playing. Now, I didn't have Logic back then, like when I used to live in the UK and live at home and practice and do all that stuff. So I would jam along to records. And then I got to Berkeley and I would be actually spending way more time playing with real musicians because they were just available all the time. So I got to practice with some of the greatest drummers in the world at Berkeley. So that was awesome, real-time practicing. But then when I got my first laptop, when I moved to New York and I started doing some production and some sampling and chopping up beats, and I would use this program called Peak, which I believe a bunch of mastering engineers still use. And it was basically a simple waveform editor, and I would just take little 4-bar loops. I would sample them from records and bring them into the computer, put them into Peak and loop them and just jam for hours and hours and hours. I have that folder somewhere. It's sitting on an old hard drive or on an old laptop. I will endeavor to find that and show you all of the loops that I used to practice with like 15, 20 years ago when I first lived in New York. So that will actually be pretty interesting. I must make a note to find that. That will make for a really cool vlog. Maybe I'll even make those little things downloadable if I can, if that isn't in breach of some sort of copyright. They were just little samples, great stuff to practice with. And I've been reading the comments recently on the vlog and people saying, you know, they love hearing the solo stuff and the improvisation, all that stuff, but they also like hearing my actual bass playing, my groove playing as well, and that there's something to that. Like I am actually a bass player at the end of the day. As much as I do play a lot of melodic stuff and chordal stuff and improvisation, you know, the main part of my career has been spent playing a bass very similar to this and playing as a fundamental element of a rhythm section. And this has been kind of my process for developing that, just jamming along to loops. Obviously, transcription of great bass lines. See, this is so ghetto the way I have it set up with this headphone extender. Anyway, you know, I used to transcribe a lot of bass lines, of course, and Jameson and Bootsy Collins. I used to listen to a lot of James Brown, and I used to listen to a lot of Motown and Stax, like kind of some 70s R&B stuff. I used to listen to the Beatles. I used to listen to Led Zeppelin, Rolling Stones, kind of a lot of the classic stuff. But then the application of that and the finding of where that vocabulary sat in my playing was about experimenting. Now, the thing I was playing when I started out this video, you'll notice that it was centered pretty much around the root. Something like that, just root and fifth. Let's play that groove again a little bit. When I first started playing with this particular loop, about 30 seconds before I started filming today's vlog, I just sat there and listened to it for a while. I just let it run. And I knew I wanted to hit the downbeat of the bar pretty solidly. That was the first thing that leapt out at me. But then there's that accented snare drum. That one. So I felt like that was like a natural place to catch the accent, and that was how the bass line got started. And then I seem to remember just now that I started with the flat 7. I'm in the key of D minor here, and I ended up starting with the flat 7 on the downbeat instead of the root as a little variation. And then I had some fills where I dropped down to the minor third, and then I changed it and I dropped down to the major third. So I was experimenting between kind of D minor and D7. And just kind of moving around there. Nothing complicated, really nothing outside of chord tones or basic pentatonic harmony, so no need for anyone to freak out and be like, oh my God, what was that? Really, really simple stuff to grasp, just thinking about the root, about the downbeat, and about listening to the groove and what I might want to catch. It's great to be able to play with the drums, and it's great to be able to play musically against the drums as well. I could play something kind of like a counterpoint thing to the drums, rhythmically speaking, and that could be super hip. I wouldn't necessarily have to lock into everything, but kind of normally my initial, whenever I hear something for the first time, my initial thing is like, how do I lock in as tight as I possibly can with the drummer, and not just the drummer, but the rest of the band. Right now it's just a drum track. And what I want to do, and the reason I'm kind of like putting all this together and figuring out, okay, I can have the laptop here and monitors and all this stuff, is because I want to develop VBL to have this massive groove library. And I'm gonna have a groove like this, real simple groove, and then write simple chord changes to go with it, so we're not stuck, you know, staying static, or at least we have something else like a harmonic element as well as a rhythmic element to play against, so we can build up this huge library that will be coming very soon. So again, thank you for being the guinea pigs as we roll along and play some funk today. And I'm gonna work a little bit more on this groove right now and try and find some more things. I'm gonna go firstly, like I said, in the pocket, try and play really with the drums, and then maybe try and find some syncopated ideas, some rhythmic displays that isn't completely locked in with the drums in terms of the exact orchestration and instrumentation of the drum set, but it's still servicing the groove, and it's still funky, and it still grooves. And again, this comes down to time and sound. If your time is great and your sound is great, you can make so many more things work. It opens up a world of options for you when you dial in those two specific things. Glitches in the matrix. Damn, I wish I'd known that was coming. That was quite hip. And if I could go back, I would sample that and actually make that into a really weird, metrically modulated fill. But I hope you heard what I was doing there. I was coming across some kind of syncopated ideas. Can I remember what they were? So it wasn't necessarily locking in with the drummer, it was playing more on the upbeats. And I find, like with bass lines like this, when I want to add some motion to it, I'll find an upbeat here or there to give it that push forward. I'm not going to rush, and I'm not necessarily going to play on top of the beat, but I am going to work with the upbeat, and that always tends to give me this feeling, this kind of lifting feeling, and that forward motion without having to play ahead of the beat or rush at all. That's a really cool tool that I use whenever I want to kind of get some motion in the bass line and get it moving forward. So not kind of being static and always on the downbeat, but using some upbeats. Let's see if the computer lasts long enough for me to do a little bit of that. So we can go right on the downbeat here and be kind of static in the groove. 1, 2, 3, Now, Now I'm going to try adding some upbeats and give it a little bit of motion. 2, 3. Kind of like, you know, the similar concept to when you're soloing and improvising, and you're, because I am improvising here for sure, where you're creating tension and release, and you're creating this kind of question and answer, you're having this conversation. This one just happens to be happening in the low end of the instrument and playing a much more supporting role than when I'm soloing and when I'm improvising in the higher register of the instrument. So there are so many parallels between the two, and I think the work I've done at both ends of the spectrum end up, you know, cross-pollinating and supporting each other. And that was great to come up with some chords there. I really dig that, throwing some of those tenths in. Again, it's the real simple things and the simple phrases that I think are most effective. And the less you use them, the more effective they're going to be. You know, I wouldn't want to be filling every single bar with a ton of harmonic and rhythmic information. It's really cool to have that patience and just sit right back and kind of, you know, check everything out. And then maybe when people are least expecting it, just bam, 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 you know, and that'll make people kind of turn around and listen or react, hopefully react in a great way to it. You know, I think it's our role. I think any musician, I think the bass plays a really important role in the band. I'm not going to say it's the most important instrument, because I think everyone is responsible for making everyone else around them sound great, and for being responsible for their own time and sound and not relying on like the drummer or the bass player or someone else for those kind of fundamental elements. But I do think we have a great responsibility when it comes to the vast spectrum of things we can cover in terms of harmony and rhythm and melody and all of these elements that we can possibly add to the music. And it's great to know all of those elements and understand and have a great command of all those elements. But more importantly, it's great to know when to use them. Have a think about all that stuff. Leave me some comments. Let me know what you think about the sound. Hopefully that really worked out and it's sounding great. And I have a few weeks to dial it in and get set up in the new place and really, really make the new studio happen and be able to produce some amazing new content for VBL based around the groove. And I'm not sure exactly where I'm going to start or what it's going to encompass, but it is going to encompass a lot of groove playing and four-string stuff and real kind of fundamental role of the instrument elements, which is just hugely important. So today's vlog is done. I will see you guys tomorrow. I'm going to play out with a little more of this. I wish I knew where this groove was from, actually. It just says tempo. It just says tempo funk break. I'll see you guys tomorrow.